Hello, everyone. It's me, David Smerdon, the Grandmaster from Australia, finally back on Banter Blitz. I've been away for a while. Apologies for that. You can blame my internet connection. We're back and we're ready to go. I'm excited to be back on ICC Banter Blitz, now streaming live on YouTube as well. So if you haven't checked out the YouTube channel, go have a look there. I've got some interesting comments of people writing there. We're going to get started pretty soon. So get into channel 3 if you're on ICC. Leon's already put the instructions there to match Smurfo 3-2-U. Get in the queue to play me. A whole bunch of people have already been suggesting openings. That's what I like to do. You suggest the openings. I'll try my best to play them out. Got some good suggestions. I've got to write another one down. Berlin. Who suggested the Berlin? What a horror. Of course it's Dodgy. Dodgy, one of the classic regulars for ICC Banner Blitz, always suggests some bizarre openings. The Berlin with G5, he says. I don't know how we'll go with that. But anyway, get yourself in the queue. We're going to have a great time tonight. Play a bit of Blitz. Good chance to beat up a Grandmaster, this guy right here. And off we go. And it is Dodgy. So Dodgy, he's actually had the first suggestion of the opening that I should play. Dodgy's got a pretty good record against me, to be honest. He said to play the Catalan with G4. Now, he didn't necessarily mean specifically I had to play it against him. He just meant to play it in general. But I think given the fact that he's having a bit of a think here on move 2, he probably realizes that that's what I'm going to do. Now, I got to be honest, Dodgy didn't give me too much information about this Catalan with G4 opening. None of us have ever heard of it before. So I'm just trying the best I can to come up with whatever it is Dodgy meant. But unfortunately, that means that it's probably not going to be too much theoretical value that you're going to get from this particular game, because it's completely bizarre opening already. Still, on the other hand, it's not too dissimilar an opening that used to be played by a very eccentric grandmaster. Now, I'm going to get the name right. Is it Namdandian? Naldandian? I'm not sure. Initially Armenian in origin, international master, played some very interesting openings in his time. Was actually famous for answering 1d4 with knight f6, and then after knight f3, just playing h6 with the idea to play e5. Looks a bit weird. That's pretty much the closest I can think of in terms of what we have here in this game. We've really got something offbeat. But anyway, let's see how we go. Position looks, well, I have no idea. I've never seen anything like this before in my life. Looks pretty much balanced, I guess I'd say. Dodgy playing quite aggressively. He has a pretty good track record against me. Here he's gone in the center with an early e5. I guess, I mean, me having played g4, it makes sense to go against my king. But on the other hand, now he's created a bit of a weakness of the d pawn. Speaking of pawns, I seem to have just popped one, which is a bit unfortunate. It's the one on h3. That I'm most worried about here. And that's a bit of a shame. This calls for a sacrifice, because it was a unexpected... he hasn't taken the pawn on h3. That's a little bit odd. I really expected that one to go. So might have given me a tiny little sniff back in this game now. Queen takes d5, perhaps head for an endgame. I'm still going to drop the h3 pawn. Definitely Dodgy's got the upper hand here. That's already a very good start by the challengers, the combatants. That's all of you guys. It's not a good start by me in my first return to Banner Blitz after, must be about 3 months. We'll have a bit of a chat if we get time about why that's the case and why I've been off air for so long. Now, interesting decision here for Dodgy. He's got to do something about the knight on g5. Knight takes f3. Yeah, that's a pretty safe and sound decision. The other option was knight takes h3, but after king g2, it's not really clear what would have happened. At least now, it's clear that Dodgy's just got a slight advantage. It's probably what he was after at this stage. So a pretty sound, sensible decision. Can't be faulted. Now, what am I going to do about this? I have a serious problem with my king. And that all came about because Dodgy encouraged me to play this g4 move. I'm also falling a little bit behind on the clock, so I've got to be a bit careful here. I'd say that position is slightly better for black on account of the two bishops and white's exposed king, let's not forget. But, you know, things could be worse here. Queen c8's probably coming. No, queen b6. That's, again, a tiny bit unexpected. Dodgy continues to surprise me, but the position looks pretty normal. We might have a bit of an exchange of rooks on the d file, I fear. But so the two bishops are often considered to be an advantage without much understanding of why that's the case. In this position, it's almost certainly the case that the two bishops are an advantage, but that's because it's so open. The bishop has got a lot more scope to work with. And you can see I have a serious problem with my knight. I just can't find a nice square for him. Now, that's an interesting move by Dodgy. It could be a tad risky if queen takes b7 works. Wow, that would be absolutely amazing if queen takes b7 worked in this position. I'm just not sure if it works or not, and I don't have any time. Let's do it. All right, first banner blitz back on ICC. Queen sacrifice, baby. That's what I'm talking about. I'm honestly not sure whether that works or not. Because queen takes b7, rook takes d8, and now bishop f8 might just refute my entire idea, and I might be going home with a loss to start this off. Let's see what happens. It's certainly a dodgy thing. This may be the worst start to a return to banner blitz by any grandmaster on ICC, or the best. Let's find out. Dodgy, he's down. Oh, he's played bishop d4. He hasn't gone in for it. He hasn't gone in for it. Now, that is surprising. I'm just going to bail out here. I know it's not a very manly thing to do, but I just forgot to pay attention for a second there. I forgot to pay attention. He took with the bishop on d8. He didn't take with the rook, and I've just blundered a pawn on h3 as well. Oh, that's tragic. Hey, he hasn't taken it. Well, honestly, I now have no idea what's going on. I can tell you what I do know, which is that I've got absolutely no time, so I better try and move as quickly as I can to keep any chances in this game. That was a comedy of errors. Oh dear, this is all gone downhill now. I don't know how that happened. Oh dear, idea. I was actually looking forward to seeing what would happen after that queen sacrifice. So that's a bit of a shame, really. But anyway, so be it. Here we are. It's probably looking like a draw now, if I'm being entirely honest. I can't imagine there's going to be too much happening here. Yeah, looks pretty drawn. Maybe it's not. Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear, I just played a bad move. Oh dear, oh dear, I just played another one. All right, maybe not a draw anymore. Maybe not. If he gets his bishop around, it's game over. It's game over, but he hasn't managed just yet, and I've snuck my king back in, and that's going to help the situation quite a lot. Oh, that's a bad move by Dave right there, blundering a pawn. Oh, he misses it. Oh, this is... What is going on here? We've got no time left. In comes his king. That's not a good sign. Oh, he's blundered a rook. He's blundered a rook. Well, I should say the exchange, and we're going to have a draw. How do I offer a draw? Someone tell me how I offer a draw in this position. I'm going to, there we go. Draw. Oh, what a start, guys. Unbelievable start to that game. I was really proud of my queen sacrifice. The bluff seemed to work and won myself a pawn. Then complete brain explosion playing rook takes d8 when I thought he'd put a rook there. Instead, he put a bishop. Then dodgy quickly built up the upper hand. I think a draw is probably the fairest result that we could have had. That was incredible. What a start. All right, Trent David. All right. Now, what was I told to play? I can't remember. Against d4. I gotta relax a little bit after that. Extraordinary start. What an unbelievable game. Whew. All right. Good stuff, guys. Good stuff. Now, Trent David is also a bit of a regular, we should say, to Banter Blitz. Oh, man, that was intense. From Spain. All right, so let's try and calm ourselves down, get back into things here. I have to say this position, I don't really know what's going on. Seems to be reasonably okay. I'm just still thinking about what could or couldn't have happened in that last game. That was a truly incredible fight. But okay, back to the real world here. I've lost a little bit of time on the clock while discussing what happened then. But it shouldn't be anything too bad. This position looks pretty boring, far more subdued than the last epic battle we had there. Trent David's got a slight advantage. Nothing too serious, I'd say. So I'm feeling reasonably comfortable in this position. This is a very typical sort of endgame that you end up with, particularly in Queen's Gambit Accepted, which is the opening that we've had here. Yes, like I said, it's very typical sort of position. He's Trent David, who I'm going to assume is male, but please excuse me if that's incorrect, has a slight advantage in that he's got the use of the c4 square. Note that I have the corresponding outpost on c3, but it's very difficult for me to make use of it. So typically that means that it's just a very, very slight advantage to the first player. And by first player, we mean white here, but nothing too serious. So a very small advantage to white. Not sure about bishop d4. With those pawns on b3 and b4, I would have been inclined myself to think that white would have wanted to keep the dark squared bishop, maybe try and swap off the light squared bishop. So that could have been a slightly strange decision. Remains to be seen how important that will be. Probably not too much. It's probably just an equal position. Is my guess. Now, things starting to heat up just a little bit, because remember I said black usually can't exploit that c3 outpost, and that's because white usually had a bishop on b2, but that's kind of changed now, so I might actually have some chances to use it. Now, knight c3 here allows bishop takes b7, followed by a nasty knight c6 check. I wonder whether I can get away with that anyway in this position. Oh, I really can't calculate today's, but I think I can play knight c3 anyway. So bishop takes b7. For some reason, brain doesn't seem to be working too well, but I'll stop making excuses. Now, how about that move? Is that any good? I'm not so sure. There could be some chances here. Let's have another sacrifice. I'm feeling in the mood to sacrifice today. Bishop takes f3. My big idea was, it's coming up, drum roll please, ladies and gentlemen, there we go, knight e2 check. Dave sees a tactic, and I think that's working out for me here because of that b3 pawn. And this works, and I believe we can now say that it has. It all goes back to White giving up that c3 outpost, that key difference, really the only difference in the symmetry between the positions. Okay, so now a difficult job here for Trendave to try and save this position. I'm not sure it is savable, to be honest. Knight d3 check looks like a strong move, and if a4 drops, that's game over. And I think a4 is dropping here. Well, f2 is just dropped instead, but he's desperately trying to hold on, but I don't think he's going to be able to do it here. It's now two pawns. King c4 follows, and knight e5 check is really the last chance. I expect he'll go, oh no, he hasn't done that. He's gone for knight d2. That's not going to be good enough, I think. Knight f3 check is going to be met by king c5. And so instead he's gone for five sensible choice, but now the a pawn's going to drop off and it's way too many pawns. So I'm going to claim my first victory in 3 months on Banter Blitz, which is a strange thing to say. Assuming everything goes all right, let's not count the chickens just yet, but it's certainly looking that way at the moment. Whew! What a cracking start. What a start. I should say, while Trent David does his best to find a way to rescue his position and hold on for as long as possible, Dodgy, what an impressive performance. I mean, it was just a quality game all around, but in terms of entertainment value, for sure. But what an impressive performance. Definitely, definitely we can call that was completely uncompromising chess, as they say. Nice little finesse here in this game, f6, because it just keeps the knight away. And now you'll see, oh, whoops, I was about to say, how great am I? I allowed knight d4 check. Fortunately, Trent David resigned, and the position was, in fact, still winning for black. But I just popped my head for a second. Again, knight c5 was the way to go there. So, woe is me, tired dad. Hello, tired dad. Good to hear from you. Now, let's check what options I've got to play. Someone has asked me to play the Slav. Now, it's complicated somewhat by the fact that I know nothing about the Slav. I was asked to play either the Slav or the Semi-Slav. At least I can honestly say that I don't know the difference between the two. But it looks like this game is transformed into something else. I definitely know that D5 and C6 are involved in the Slav, whether it's Slav, Semi-Slav, Note Boom, Triangle, Chebanenko Slav. To be honest, I'm not entirely familiar with all of these, but it looks like we're in something pretty different anyway now, because Tired Dad making a small error playing knight c3. The problem was that if he played the normal response to d4, which is knight e4, then I was going to follow up with f5, and would you believe it, that knight would have been trapped. So actually, Tired Dad, a little mistake there with knight c3, probably should have played d3, the idea being, excuse me, that after a subsequent knight c3, d4, putting the knight on e4, he would have been able to retreat the knight to d2 if necessary. Instead, that means that Tired Dad's had to retreat the knight. I've actually wasted a move, in a sense, by playing the move e7 to e6, followed by e6 to e5. So I've wasted one move. Tired Dad's wasted two moves, in a sense, because he's played knight to c3 and back to b1. What that translates to, for those of you who are counting, is that I believe we've actually got a standard Benoni-type opening with colors reversed. So somehow I've taken over now the white pieces virtually. It's not as much help as you might think, because I know nothing about playing the white side of a Benoni. So it's not really too much help in this situation. But Tai Dad doing the right thing from a Benoni perspective, which is swapping off the queen's bishop. This bishop g5, bishop takes f6. That was quite important. So that was well played. On the other hand, this knight does not belong on b3. And the reason is because of the move I've just played, c5. And you can see that knight on b3 is just biting against granite now. So generally, that's not where the knight goes. That's a tiny little strategic error. And that's going to cost Tired Dad a tiny bit of time, I think. Because eventually that knight, there we go. And it just justifies the point that knight's going to have to reroute. And that's exactly what Tired Dad's done. So he's done the right thing in a sense. Now I'm gonna go a little bit crazy because that's the theme that we have accidentally found ourselves in tonight. I've sacrificed a pawn here with e4 followed by f4. This is a standard attacking idea for white in the Benoni, played quite often by the fantastic world champion Mikhail Tal, the Latvian world champion, back when Latvia was still part of the USSR. Now, I don't really remember how Mikhail Tal used to follow this up, so I might not be much use from here, which is a bit of a strange thing to say. But that's definitely how he started things off, that's for sure. So he used to often play the move with white e5 and after takes f5. So I've done the reverse here, e4 followed by f4. But here, I think I might have messed things up because, I really want to keep that pawn there on e4. If I had to play bishop takes f5, then suddenly all of Dodgy's pieces would have come out. It wouldn't have been worth the pawn that I would have captured because of, first of all, bishop takes b7 at the end of the variation, but also putting the knight onto e4. So actually that pawn on e4 is probably doing me more of a favor than it's doing white in this position. So that's the reason, in case you're wondering why I didn't play the obvious move, bishop takes f5 in that position. You can see the position is just a tiny bit uncomfortable at the moment for Tired Dad. Tiny bit uncomfortable. Perhaps it's not too serious. Tired Dad, he plays some fantastic games against me. We've had some great battles. But you can see that pawn on e4, it's just blocking everything in the position at the moment. So that's really the thing that's giving me my best chances here. Now, this is an interesting moment. I'm going to retreat the bishop. There was also an option to play knight takes f3 here. And while I am a pawn down, that doesn't worry me in the slightest. The only thing that worries me is Tired Dad's bishop on g2 managing to escape. That's the thing that I'm desperate to prevent. Tired Dad really playing quite well, but as is always the case when we play against each other, just getting a little too low on time. I think that this could be a serious problem. Ah, an excellent move there. F3. That was definitely the best chance. I guess the idea is to follow up with E3. A really nice move. Puts a bit of pressure on me, actually. I'm going to put a rook on D8. That's to cut out the move E3. I really want to stop the move E3 being played. He's gone queen c2. He can't waste too much time, both on the clock and on the board, because my attack is still going. I know he wants to get the move e3 in, and this might be his last chance, actually. I think he's got to go e3 here, but even then, and he's gone queen back. I think that's not going to be good enough. Let's see what happens. Is he going to go h4? I guess that was his idea. He's gone takes. That's risky. Now queen h8 is coming. Queen h8 is coming. Ooh. What happened there? Hey. Oh, it's my move still. I don't know. Sorry, my computer froze. Fortunately, I'm not the one with 14 seconds. Tired Dad in desperate situation. e5. Last chance e5. And good that he found it. That was really necessary move. But there's bishop f5. Now queen d2 is the only move. Oh, he hasn't done it. And that means that check is coming, followed by mate in 2. Bishop takes d3, and after bishop f3, there's three mates in one. Rook takes f3, queen f2, and queen h1. A great game by Tyre Dad. Nice for us to get into a more typical opening there. That was, like I said, a reverse Benoni, and my Mikhail Tal sacrifice managed to work, although perhaps wasn't entirely convincing. Thanks to the game, Tyre Dad. Another good battle. And we're on again now. What other openings was I supposed to play? The Torre was called. Let's try that one. Well, I hope you don't mind if I play a Trump instead of a Torre. My opponent is from Saint-Pierre and Miquelon. Saint-Pierre and Miquelon. Is that a country? You have to excuse me. I've never heard of it before, but that's not to say that it's not. I'm just very bad with these things. Saint-Pierre and Miquelon. It was only recently that I learned about Saint-Tome and Principal, I guess I'm just not the sort of person to ask about these things, but still, what an interesting name for a country. Okay, off we go again. I tried to play a Torre. It's not entirely a Torre, so we're already in something a bit different. I think it was Tyre Dad again who asked me to play this. I can't quite remember. Now, e5 could follow here, and to be honest, I'm quite unhappy with my position. I'm really tempted to just sacrifice a pawn here with e4, but I'm worried about takes and queen b4 checks, so I'm going to play c3 and then play e4. I really need to get my king safe. If I get my king safe, I'm going to have a slight advantage because black really has nowhere to castle now, having played g takes f6. So if my king's safe, I got the advantage. But on the other hand, black has a bit of activity, two bishops, and the chance to put a rook on the semi-open g-file. So it's really anyone's game at the moment. Oh, good chance here to gain a tempo with bishop c4. That's good news for me because it means I can castle next move. I see, said the blind man. It looks to me like my opponent, he wants to castle queenside with bishop d7 and castle queenside. So I'm going to sneak in a little queen b3 on that move. The whole idea is to hit the b7 pawn. So if bishop d7, although to be honest, after bishop d7, I'm not entirely sure I can take that pawn. In any case, not something we have to worry about anymore because my opponent has gone for rook g8. Now, looks super risky to castle, and I really don't want to do it. And typically, if I don't want to do things, I don't do them. So I'm going to play g3, which also looks a bit ugly, but somehow castling kingside seemed to me to be a little bit scarier. Getting caught up in my cables. One of these days, I'll get one of those wireless headsets and look super cool. There's bishop d7. That's the move I was afraid of, actually. So props to my opponent because it's not what I wanted to see. Now I have a little bit of an issue. What to do? If I take the pawn, then the rook goes to b8. And tough position. I'm not happy at all with the way this has gone. Yeah, okay, so we're going to try and rescue the situation now. Bishop b2 is sort of playing a bit of damage control, to be honest. Not entirely the move that I wanted to play, but the situation has gone a little pear-shaped here. I'm pretty sure... Yeah, black can safely castle queenside. That's a good move, and that's not a move I wanted to see because this situation is quickly becoming uncomfortable. I'm castling queenside, but now bishop h6 should follow, and that's an excellent diagonal for that bishop to be on. He hasn't played it, which does surprise me. I'm going to run my king away. That is a little bit odd. Excuse my sniffling. I'm an Australian in Europe in winter. This is not what I was programmed for. Okay, bishop goes to c5. I'm going to keep running the king because I have a feeling that king safety is going to be the main ingredient that's going to decide this game. My opponent's playing a very, very nice game so far. I think I made a little error there. I think I should have played knight e4. There's now a chance for my opponent to play. I should stop saying my opponent. Random is his name. I'm not so convinced about that move. I'm not so convinced. I'm going to play knight e4 as I drop under a minute on the clock. Whoa, what did I just do? Did I just lose a piece? I'm not so convinced by my move now, Dave. What were you thinking? Actually, it turns out that my little finger fellow there might not have been so bad. Let's see what I can do here. Knight takes f6. Is that a possibility? I think it is, actually. I might have actually just accidentally played a brilliancy, in which case I'm going to claim it. What a great move. What an accidental great move. The problem with this live streaming is that if I play an accidental brilliancy, you will know that it's accidental. So I'm a piece down, but so many pieces on pre in this position. I think there's four pieces being attacked here of black's pieces. So that's good news for me because you can only move one of them. There's no good square for that queen. And that probably wasn't the best move because now, how much time have I got left? Not a whole lot. All right. Knight takes e7. Rook takes d7, and he's found an excellent move there. An excellent move. Really seriously running behind on the clock. I'm not sure exactly how that happened, but I'm going to have to start doing some serious time management. I just missed rook d8 there, which was probably winning. Let's try and rectify that now, pushing a second pawn up. That's not a good move by my opponent. That could come back to hurt, actually. Running a bit short on time. Come on. I'm starting to fade a little bit. I've got to try and improve my blitz abilities. Queen goes there. That's not a good move. Rook d2. Oh, he's got queen c5. That might keep him in the game. Rook d4. Queen goes in again. Oh, running out of time. Running out of time. 19 seconds left. Bishop takes d4. Rook d4. Oh, I dropped my queen. Oh, I meant to play rook d8 in that position. We'll have to check later whether rook d8 was any good because that was just the kind of ridiculous. That's a shame. And we can resign that game now. First loss. Wow, it'd be very interesting. I wish I could go back and check. I don't have the time now, but I believe I could have played rook d8 in that position instead of wherever I let the rook go. But he could have played queen takes queen, so it wouldn't have mattered. Now we can just say that was just a horrible, horrible, horrible game. The other rook to d4. Of course, moving the other rook to d4 would have won. Well, there's a little bit of justice there, I guess, for my opponents. You can dodgy, tired dad, and Trent David, you can all claim a bit of that victory to yourselves. Okay. Right. Don't usually play f5, mainly because I don't typically know what's going on, and that certainly seems to be the case here. No idea. Never seen this before. Not sure what's going on. This was a pretty poor choice by me. Great game by my opponent by random 31415 from the place that I had never heard of. Serves me right for not knowing where your country was. Fine victory. Well done. Now, time for me to get back on track and hear my opponent playing seriously cool gambit line. Always have to respect the gambit line, and this one looks quite dangerous indeed. Not even sure I can call it a gambit anymore, because I'm pretty sure I'm going to lose that pawn back. Should I be super greedy and try and hang on to it? It seems so risky, but why not? Let's see what happens. I'm going to hang on for dear life to that pawn. It's only one pawn, really. My opponent hasn't given too much away in this position and is playing very nicely, I have to say. Very, very impressed by my opponent so far. I haven't managed to castle safely yet. I'm not entirely sure I'm going to get time, to be honest. All right, let's go for it. I really need to castle, though. I think that d6 could be a good move by my opponent here. He hasn't done that. Might be something that he'll come to regret a bit later, but maybe not. I guess we'll find out eventually. I don't want to play this move, but I can't see too many other options. So there we go. It's done now. Done and dusted. Got the queens off, but he's going to win the pawn on b5. He does win the pawn on b5, and that's good news for my opponent, who is playing like a champion, I've got to say. My opponent playing seriously nice game here. All right, now, what can I do? Might try and send a knight in, but I'm a bit worried about various options for my opponent here, like knight e6, maybe d6 actually. d6 looks like a very reasonable move. What I'm banking on is getting into a king and pawn endgame, and then my passed pawn on e4 might bring me home. What a great gambit by my opponent. Good attacking play. Now, is it finally Dave's chance? I think it is. It's Dave's time to sacrifice a pawn. I've waited for this. And finally, I get the chance to sacrifice a pawn here. Very, very happy to have given up that c-pawn, but to get the d6 square, I think that that is a very reasonable trade from my perspective. So, no complaints here whatsoever. Very happy about that. I think my opponent is starting to show some signs of weakness. I have to say that last move may not have been too good either, because now knight e3 is coming. Things are starting to fall apart just a little bit here. Knight e3. And now c3 is dropping off. I'm going to get my pawn back. d5 is a sitting duck. The knight on b3 is in a bit of trouble. I'm feeling pretty confident about this game. But then again, I was what, a whole piece up in the last game? I mean, that was unbelievable, I tell you. Okay. So, now if king b2, I have a very interesting tactic. Rook takes b3, followed by knight c4 check, winning a pawn in the game, getting into a one rook and pawn game. And king b2, I have to say, is quite a possibility that my opponent will play here. Against other moves, I have the feeling that knight c4, yes, now we'll see the other idea, knight c4, and a next move, a5, looks very convincing. Yeah, so now a5, no choice but to play king a1 in this position. Oh, he's gone for a4. Well, I take it all back. That seems also quite possible. I have to say I missed that move. Although after rook b4, threatening a number of things, knight a3 is probably the main one, but also rook takes a4. This looks pretty grim, I have to say. I can't go for mass exchanges to try and bail out. So, because the king and pawn endgame is winning, so instead, he's had to give up the exchange, but that is probably tantamount to resignation as well. Now, I think I'm just going to take the pawn, not worry about the a4 pawn, because I might get my rook a little bit trapped, so I might just play like this, meet c3 with just a solid retreat. How should we do this? I think I will retreat for the time being. Yeah, I think it's time for me to get those pawns rolling. Ooh, that's an unfortunate miss there, falling into a pin. That's going to make my conversion a little bit quicker than it would have been otherwise. Thank you, Iran or Air Antrobo. I'm not entirely sure how to pronounce it, but thanks for the game. Very interesting gambit that you played there. Okay, now what other options have I got to play? I've got a lot of options for black against e4, but no one's playing e4, and now I'm white. So playing against the Thames King, I guess it is. Chance to bust out. Wow, a6. No. I'm the one playing the offbeat openings tonight. As neither of us want to play a normal opening by the looks of things. That's the way chess should be, my friends. That's the way chess should be. All right, then. If neither of us are going to play normally, how are we going to do this? This is great. This is neither of us want to be on the back foot, as we say. That's a cricket analogy for those of you who know about cricket. Neither of us want to be on the back foot, so let's go. Let's go forwards. This is not an opening you'll see in any textbooks. Let's see what's happening in the chat while my Thames King friend is. Yes, interesting stuff. All right, so hoping for bishop takes e4. I don't imagine I'm going to get it. That would have, by the way, allowed bishop takes f7. Instead, e6, very good move, and I'm a little concerned because I'm going to drop the b4 pawn here. On the other hand, that's also not the end of the world. Queen b3, knight c6 seems like the natural counter, but then I don't know. Well, it's got to be knight c6. I think that's the only logical try here, but then, a5. Yeah. Might be also okay. I'm just a little suspicious of that move, but it might be okay. Castles. Now, I've got the advantage in development. Time to really make something of it. I feel this is a critical moment. If Black can castle, get his pieces out, and consolidate the extra pawn, then he's going to be better for sure. But still, he's a few moves off being able to do that. So we're going to... We've got an interesting few moves ahead of us here. Knight c6, it just doesn't feel quite right, but maybe it's okay. I don't know. I would really have been focusing on my kingside development there. And now d5 is coming. If Black's king is stuck in the center when the center opens up, there's going to be carnage. He's going to be stuck in no man's land. He'd really like to play the move castles here, but he's still got that knight on g8 to worry about. And d5 is coming next move. This could be a problem. I think that last move was an error. Yeah, Thames King, I think he's realized the gravity of the situation. Now, this often happens in the wing gambit, actually. It's a bit of a slow burner of a gambit. Here it was quite a slow burner because I didn't get to sack the pawn until move 8, but still, it's a slow burner. The pieces come into the middle and lacks development and coordination just isn't as simple as it first appears. Now, Temskin could have really done himself a favor by being able to castle by not playing his last move, knight c6. He's now played knight e7. It may be too late. We're about to find out, but I suspect it's a little too late. And, well, let's not count our chickens. Can I play rook takes? No. D6 is such a tempting move here, but I'm not sure it's the best. I think the best is actually to take, see what my opponent recaptures with here. Not a trivial decision, has to be said. Take him with the D pawn. Might be okay. Also, a tiny bit of a risky decision. So now I've got a couple of interesting options. I think I'm going to bust in now. Knight g5. Temskin's in serious time trouble. It does have an extra pawn. Lots of tempting sacrifices now, honestly. Wowee. Bishop takes e6. Is that the move, perhaps? Is that the killing blow? It looks good. I'm not sure if it's winning, though. Ooh, it could be winning, but I'm just not sure. I guess we're going to go for it. Temskin down to 25 seconds. He's having to move quickly, and he has moved quickly. Now his queen's under attack. I've got a perpetual if I want it. I don't want it, but I need to find another move here. And it's not obvious. I might have just popped a piece very much. Chance to move the... Yes, he's done that. He's moved the king. That's a good move. That's a good move, and now excellent chances here for the draw. I need to find something big here. Knight d5 is probably not big enough, I think. He's probably going to take that. I've got the pre-move on. Take back. I've got control of the a-file, but there's only so much that I can do with it. I really need to get my pieces into good working position here. I'm running short on time myself. I'm going to play rook d1. That leaves f2 undefended. I'm not entirely happy with that move. I had to go queen g3 now. He's played knight e4. That's okay. I think that's okay. Where's the queen going? h4. Knight takes f2. Not quite good enough. Bishop c5 is going to be met by bishop d4. That might have been too ambitious there. I think, yeah, he was really starting to hold things together, but that move was a little too much. He's quickly fired in there with queen d6 and key h1. I've got my king into safety now. It's hard to believe that I'm going to have too many problems from this point, but who knows? Queen d4. He's got a problem on g7 now. Starting to run down on time. Rook d3 might be a good move here, or it could be a very bad move. I'm not entirely sure whether I could take that pawn because of queen e1. I think actually I could have. I didn't. I perhaps should have. Situation still not clear. Queen e1 not quite working. Unfortunately, a1 is covered. Oh, exciting finish to that game. Wow, we were, as they say. What a game. What a game. Amazing game. Really enjoyed that. Thanks for that. I'm going to play the Khan now against Mate or Die, who's from the UK. Yeah, let me mention at the outset that I have never played the Khan before in my life, but I'm going to do so here. It was recommended by, now I can't remember who it was who told me to play the Khan. actually, but was one of the openings that I was asked to play, and so here we are. And I'm certainly going to give it my all. So wish me luck, guys, and we'll find out whether I've got any Khan ability or not. Yeah, so I don't really know what's going on. There's F4. That's the good move. That's the one that was worrying me a tiny bit. I don't know now. I don't know about this position. It just doesn't feel very good. I don't want to play the check either. Something's gone a bit wrong here already. You can see my opponent hasn't used a single second yet. So I think I have good reason to be afraid. Yeah, I'm worried. I am worried about this. I'm not castling kingside, that's for sure. That is a no-go zone at the moment, castling kingside. So instead, I don't know what I gotta do here. Maybe I can try and block things up a little bit. Maybe I can try this check. Mightn't be such a bad move, actually. Quite like that check. Gives me some potential here to play bishop d4. Trying to set up some sort of blockade because that pawn on f5 is just such a pain. I've got to find a happy place here. I'm going to go for b4. Yeah, that's what we're going to do. And let's swap those guys off and try and set up a blockade. See if I can keep myself in this for a bit longer. This is it's not a great position, has to be said. That's good move by my opponent there, trying to open things up. That's a very good move. I wonder if I can get away with Queen D4 here. Let's try that and see where my opponent's going to go. Maybe he's going for Knight A4 here. That e4 pawn's a bit weak. That might be my get out of jail free card in this position. And you know what? Castling kingside is sort of back on the table now. That's an option. So keep that in mind. My opponent's got some serious thinking to do here. It's not entirely clear what the best move is. Queen e2 comes to mind. Knight a4 is the more ambitious attempt. I think either way, I'm going to snap that pawn up on a3. My queen on d4 is actually a tiny bit exposed. It looks extremely powerful at the moment, but if white can very quickly get a rook to d1, it might be an entirely other story. Queen to c2 instead. It's also very possible. I'm going to take that pawn off and put some pressure on the e4 pawn. Now that's making my life a tiny bit more comfortable. I'm not sure what a good move is here. H3? H3? Is it? Why can't I take that pawn now? Why can't I take that pawn? I'm not sure. I can't see a problem with taking it, so I'm gonna do it. H3 was a bit odd. Now we find ourselves here. This rook is gonna come to d1 after all. There we go. That's the problem. Should have seen that coming. That's the problem, and that is a serious issue for me. If that rook arrives on d1, that's a real shame. Should have thought ahead there. Made an error. Small error in judgment. What's going on here? Why can't I take that one off? Let's try it and see what happens. I've got rook g8.
He's found a square. Does allow queen e4.
Starting to heat up on the clock. I'm down 30 seconds here.
Now I seem to have won some material, if I'm not mistaken. 37 seconds, though. Things are getting a little bit risky, but still position looking pretty good from my perspective. I've got the extra pawn now. I've actually got two extra pawns, so I'm led to believe. And that knight does.
Not sure what happened there. I think there was a little dropout, but we're back now. No, we're not back. We're back. We're back. We're not back. Did he resign? What happened? I think he just resigned. White resigned. Yeah, so I managed to sneak my way back in there. Sorry for the small delay in connection. I told you things haven't been going fantastically well from the internet since. Oh, and I haven't turned my video on. There we go. Sorry about that, guys. We're back. Hello. Thanks for the game. That was a good one. Sorry for the strange video dropping in and out and the strange echo, apparently. Ty Dad saying, Dave's gone for the gothic echo again. Yeah, don't mind a bit of that. All right. Now, how are we going to start things off? Who am I playing against? Sunderick from the UK. A lot from the UK on tonight. I guess not much to cheer about in the cricket, so may as well stay here. I've gone with knight c3, Sunderick. Time to snap on. Come on. Let's just see whether Sunderick is around. I'll add a bit more time if he or she is, but I have a feeling. I have a feeling they've dropped out of the queue. Oh, there we go. Knight f6. All right. You can have your. You can have 20 more seconds. And now we can get ourselves going. No problem, Sunderick. Sunderick says, sorry, getting drink. I'll assume that means getting a drink rather than getting drunk. Okay. Back on. Let's play something a little bit different. I don't know what this opening is. Some sort of Vienna type system, I think. Now, traditionally in the Vienna, I shouldn't play f4 just yet, but I'm going to play f4 anyway. I'm going to play it anyway and see what we get here. Knight f3, couple of different options here for black. Bishop g4 is one of them. Actually, for some reason, I have a feeling I wasn't supposed to allow bishop g4, but I did. I think I might have just messed this up, actually, but anyway, how bad can this position be? Got a real clamp going here. I actually have a similar clamp to the clamp that my opponent had against me in the last game. That was mate or die. Had a mate or die. Got this wedge on f5 against me in the Khan. So I've got a similar type structure here. My real problem is my stupid king. I have no idea where he's going to go. Couple of nice cricket references happening in the chat there. Lulled into a false sense of security watching the Aussie top six collapse is one of the interesting comments. Clearly, you haven't been watching the test match against New Zealand. Massive scores by Australia. And to be fair, also some a recent massive score by New Zealand. So not too many cricket fans on tonight, I imagine, but let me say it's not the worst time in the world to be an Australian when it comes to cricket at the moment. Okay, let's focus on the chess. I've allowed bishop takes c3, which I imagine is pretty much forced here. That's going to give me these ugly triple isolated pawns, but on the other hand, I've got kind of an annoying pin on the knight on f6. I now control the d4 square, which is reasonably important, and if I can put some pressure on black's kingside, particularly making use of this this pin that I've got going on the knight on f6, it's going to be good news. So I'm going to try it with knight h2. No prizes for guessing where that knight's headed. And it's a little bit of pressure on Sunderick here. Very nice. Very smart play here, actually. Trying to bring the knight around. Now, I've got a choice. Do I keep the pin going? Or do I try to exploit it straight away? Tough. Tough to know what to do here. I think I'm going to just go for it. Just go for it. See what happens here. I guess knight d7 should follow. I've just got to defend that pawn on e4 before I go any further. Imagine putting a couple of rooks on the g-file here. Could be a dangerous attack. My queenside structure may look quite awkward. But on the other hand, it's doing a good job of cutting down those central squares. Now, g5 would have been met by knight f takes e4, but now g5, that response isn't worrying me too much. So it's really getting time for my opponent to come up with the goods. Because I'm coming through. Looks like it's going to be hard to stop now. G5 is coming. Choo-choo-choo. Is he going rook b2 maybe? Rook b2 looks like a sensible move here, but I'm going to play rook g2. Preparing. Giving up the a2 pawn. And here we come, boys. G5. I waited this long. There we go. Talk about patience, huh? How long did I wait for that? Wow, what self-restraint. Now, ooh, he's got knight takes e4. Is that working? Ah, you got to be kidding me. That's working. Unbelievable. I was so proud of myself. And then look at this. Take, rook check. And then what have I got? Big, fat, nothing. How much time have I got? But down the time. What about queen h4? Takes. Queen h5 might be working. Don't like it so much. f6 could be working. Gee, queen h5 is committal, though. If it doesn't work, I am in all sorts of trouble. Okay, let's do it. It's banter blitz. Come on, queen h5. I'm not feeling very confident about that move. Oh, I was so happy about g5, and now I just don't know. I just don't know anymore, guys. I just don't know. There's f6. That's not the move I wanted to see. Bishop h6, rookie f7, I guess, and then across and takes. It's looking pretty good, isn't it? Rook takes, 97 across, take. Looks good. Is it winning? That's the big question. Ooh, woohoo, knight g5, hello. Is that working, huh? Did not see that, if I'm being totally honest. My opponent's in some serious time trouble here. Gee, knight e4 looks like a good move here. Ooh, what happened? My opponent ran out of time. What was I going to do after knight e4? Not sure. I thought that queen takes f7 might be working, but actually now I'm not convinced anymore. So that's a bit of a shame. I thought my opponent played an outstanding game there, Sonarek. I got to be honest. Whew. Wow, what a convincing display tonight, huh, guys?
Not.
Okay. Sorry about that. Thanks for the game. That was a good one. All right, Dantanucci. No rest for the wicked. We are straight back into it. What sort of opening is this? I've never seen this before. I mean, by me. That was a cracking game. Whoa! Ho! Ho, ho, ho. Picked up a pawn there. Wow, that was a nice game. I'm not even sure if I was winning, though, against Sunderick. That was... Was it Sunder LC? I'm not sure I even got the name quite right there, but that was a very interesting game. I'm quite interested to know what would have happened if the game had continued. Sadly, we didn't get the chance, but anyway, not to worry. C3. Yeah, I have to move my knight away. That's a little bit sad. Don't really want to move him away. He's been doing a good job. Alright, I gotta have to get some development going here, so take knight f6. I've picked up a pawn pretty cheaply though, which is usually a good sign. Problem is my knight doesn't really have any nice squares to go to. E6 is a bit ugh, a bit yuck. But a pawn is a pawn is a pawn, as they say, or as they should. Alright. Knight c5, hoping for queen b4, which would end the game pretty... Oh, queen b4! Oh, picked it! Picked it! Wow. Cheapies. Never let it be said that there's no room for cheapies in chess. In fact, I might even get mate in one here if he takes back on b4. Yeah, queen d1. Oh! Got a short one in there. Whew! It's about time. Things haven't been going my way tonight, so I was due for a bit of luck, and unfortunately came at the wrong time. Okay. Kingfish. Kingfish from La States. Hey, I tell you what, let's have another wing, shall we? Let's have another wing, and there it is. Oh, I love the wing gambit. Oh, I know you guys haven't seen me in a while, but last time I was on here, which was... I can't remember now. A couple of months ago, for sure. Last time I was on here, we had a bit of a wing fiesta. I got a whole bunch of wing gambits in there. I had a real good time. Might try and do a bit of the same here. What's happening? I kind of like this position. He's not going to go for c4, is he? I bet. Whoa. He really doesn't want to take that pawn. I really want him to take that pawn. Tough decision here because both c4 and c takes d4 are structurally better for white. So realistically, the only principled move is to take the pawn. But I get the feeling that Kingfish does not want to. And indeed, he's taken the other pawn. And yeah. Well, I guess I should probably just go in for the end game, but I don't really want to go for the end game, but I'm going to go for the end game. I think it's a sensible choice. My opponent doesn't want the end game. What is going on today, honestly? All right. All right, we got a game now. Okay, so knight c6. Not sure what the best square is for my... My queenie. Let's put her on f4 for the time being. I'm expecting a knight e7, knight g6, but that's not going to concern me too much. Ooh, really? So, it's a fight you want, huh? Okay, let's do this. Wow, this is amazing. This is going to get hot. This is going to be good. I still haven't castled. That's a little bit of a concern here. And my opponent could consider f6. Gone for f6. Yeah, I thought that might happen. That's not bad, actually. That's not a bad move. Makes my life a bit annoying, actually, because he's going to take the pawn and then... I don't have a... Yeah, I got to say, Kingfish is making me sweat here. Still... Whoa, I don't know about that. With the knight? With the knight, I'm not so convinced that was the way to go. My bishop's a bit of a beast now. Yeah, not so convinced about that one. Not really some... Yeah... Kind of think that was a bit of a let off, if I'm being totally honest. Should have taken with the pawn, and after knight takes played bishop d6, that looked like a much more testing possibility. Now I'm not sure. My king's going to be safely tucked on the king side. If I'm lucky, I can roll this baby through without having to worry about it. Ooh, you know, I'm not so sure that was the way to go. I mean, that C file looks so juicy. Yeah, bishop takes pawn, but that's got to be losing straight away, I think. Bishop E4, and it's should be curtains now. I think there's actually a very cute win here, if I'm not mistaken. Is bishop b8 winning? Is that winning? Looks cute. I think it is. I think it is. Bishop b8. That's a reasonably cute way to finish things off. Yeah. Yeah, this, I think the problem with openings like the Wing Gambit, which I love so much, is that thanks for swimming with the fish, says Kingfish. Thank you. I think that means he's about to resign. Yeah, the problem with the Wing Gambit is that unfortunately, it really has to be accepted. Fortunately, it's a dodgy opening for White, which means someone like Dodgy and me, we enjoy it. But realistically speaking, it should be, if anything, better for Black, or maybe it's equal, but has to be taken. The pawn on b4 has to be taken. So in this game here, move 4, the move had to be pawn takes pawn. All right, Kingfish, hit the resign button, and let's give someone else a go. Or are you going to see this out time-wise? Oh, it gives me a tiny little breather. See what's happening in the chat window. People chatting about people chatting about the new YouTube channel. Going to be immortalized on there, as is my big loss today. So I had a draw with Dodgy and a big loss. And as is always the case, due to my inflated self-sense of worth and ego, I've now forgotten the name of the person who beat me. Can someone please remind me in the chat window? I forgot. Meanwhile, Abbas Child, if you're around, jump on. Yeah, let's do this. Okay. So, game's about to start. Let me do a little bit of... Oh, I'll give you some extra time as well, because I don't think you're quite ready for that. All right, so now we're even. 3 minutes each. Yeah, I'm going to play my Scandinavian, and you know why I'm going to play my Scandinavian, because my book's out. That's right. I finally wrote a book. It took me a long time, but the one benefit of it being so long is that the publishers very kindly decided to name it after me. So, Smerdon Scandinavian. That's right. Smerdon, this guy, finally got the book out there. It's got a pretty pink cover. And one of the advantages of working on it for a year was that I learnt a lot more about my own opening than I knew before, including this line here. which is the classical system for white. You can see white just developing very normally, very logically. But one of the nice things about my favorite opening is that, typically speaking, classical development doesn't land that well. And that's the case here. So white's just played all natural developing moves, but it's already got himself in a tiny bit of trouble. Not that I can remember my theory, of course, but it seems to me that this is not the sort of position you want. I think that the pin on the d-file is a real pain. Now, maybe it's okay. I'm not quite sure here. What can he... I'm not sure knight takes e4 by Avis Chart is the way to go, because that pawn on d5 is still pinned. But even against other moves, like knight d4, I think, is a stronger move. But in this position, I would just play bishop takes e2 and then snap the pawn on d5. So, whoa, Abbas Child really going for it here. Really going for it, but this shouldn't be good enough. Because I've got a queen. Now, h3 looks like an interesting try. I'm probably going to take it off, expose the white king, but queen. What is going on? I'm going to take all these pieces. I'm going to take them all, Abbas Child. And poor Abbas Child, unsuspecting, walking into some opening preparation that I've written a 500-page huge doorstop on. But now it's queen for a bishop. And not much chance of salvation now, must be said. All right. A book should be written, Dodgy Openings. Random 31415. There we go. Thank you for mentioning it to me. It was Tired Dad who let us know. Random 31415. That's where the win came from against me. Quite a good game. Looked like I was winning in the middle there. Must have been winning. I at least had an extra exchange. But then my opponent kept it together and took me down. Okay. I don't... this is... Okay. Sorry, that didn't really make much grammatical sense, did it? All right, rook b3 check, king c8. Probably we're going to get bishop a6 check, which is what I'm hoping for, actually. Because then I'm going to play king to d8. Yep. Now I'm hoping that I get bishop to g5, which means I'm going to play queen takes g5, and the game will finish. That's how I'm going to try and wrap things up. Of course, it's equally possible that I get rook b8 check, but then after king d7, that'll also be game over. Instead now, should be mate in a couple. Let's see. Oh, where's my checkmate? One. And now... mate in two. Okay, good. And thus ended the game. Thank you, Abbas Child. Thanks for that. Like I said, falling into my pet opening there, probably the opening I know most about in the entire world. Okay, Muhid. Now, Muhid and I, we've played before, if I remember. I cannot remember how it went, but definitely we've went before. Let's wing it again. Love a bit of wing. Now, if Muhid was listening, Muhid coming from Turkey, I believe, if he or she was listening to the commentary before, they might remember that I said one really must take the pawn on b4. One really must. That hasn't happened, and that means that white is already slightly better. Only slightly, but I've said it before, and I'll say it again. Against the wing gambit, you got to take that pawn. Guys, if you want to get in on this banner blitz action, I'm told there's still a couple of spots available. So get in there right now. We're in channel 3. You just have to type, in channel 3, I think it's been written there what you have to type, or maybe we'll get Leon to write it now. But it's just match Smurfo 3 space 2 space U. Get in. I mean, there's a chance to get in some games. So jump on board. That was a good move, actually, there. Knight f6. I wasn't expecting that one. It's a bit of a pity. I'm talking about how important it was to take the pawn on b4, but my opponent doing a good job here, making my life a tiny bit tricky. Now my knight is semi-trapped out there on b5. I've got to be super careful, but on the other hand, things might be okay because I've got that c7 square to work with, so d6 might be forced, and that will make my life a bit easier. Knight takes e4 is maybe possible here. Is it? Maybe it is. Then queen e2 looks pretty good after that, so probably not. Tough position, very unusual position for the start of a game here, but I'm feeling pretty good about my chances. Super good bishop sitting there in the middle of the board. Might just play d4 here, actually, sacrifice a pawn. Why not? He hasn't taken it. It's interesting. Okay. Still have a tiny, tiny, tiny problem in that my stupid knight is sitting on b5 and not doing anything useful. And there's d6. There's the move, finally. And how much trouble am I going to get into with that knight? Bishop g4. And a4, and I'm probably out of danger there. Some threats of a5 here look kind of interesting. Ooh, a5 looks very tempting now. I'm going to go for a5. That a7 pawn has just become available. I'm liking the look of that. Yeah, I'll have one of those, please. Thank you. I'll take that guy off your hands. That rook's probably going to go back to a8 now. And can I play bishop takes a6? Kind of tempting move. Maybe there's rook takes a7. No, I'm just going to come back. I quite like that knight. My pawn on a5 is a bit weak, but should be okay. Knight c7. I'm not sure now. Knight takes c7 and e5 coming through. This could be a bit dangerous. Ooh. Have you seen this one before? This guy, bishop takes h7, the old Greek gift. That's what that sacrifice is called in the chess world. I've been hanging out for one of those. It's been a while. If king takes knight g5 and it's all over, so that probably means he's got to move the king, and he's done so. So that's good. But it generally, if this happens, if I can get my queen to the h file, it's game over. Doesn't look so easy though. There's some potential, actually. Queen g5 is now in the air. Very tempted to play queen g5 here, but no. Show some restraint. Got an extra two pawns. They're not particularly good pawns, though, I have to say. But two pawns is two pawns, so it should be smooth sailing now. Fingers crossed. Let's see what's happening in the chat. Like I said, try and get in the list to play me. It looks like there's quite a big list now, but you never know. Doesn't hurt to try. And Mohit's going to drop out on time, I guess. What just happened? I didn't get anything that told me the game was over. Is there some... Oh, move got played. Sorry, I thought my... Well, I thought I won. But apparently not. Might be some laggage happening from the sounds of things. Okay, so it still came on, but Muhit's in some serious time trouble now, and that king is seriously weak. Ooh, is that okay? Is that okay? I think that is okay, actually, my opponent's last move. I couldn't quite get the checkmate happening. It's pretty close now, and now it's serious. Now it's a serious issue. Blocked by the knight. Good move, but king g2, and I'll take that h-file. Thank you very much. He's playing all right here, actually. Playing all right, doing the right thing, getting that rook to h6. Might swap off a pair of rooks, but the attack is coming. It is pretty much unstoppable, I believe. Let's see. Queen g6. Yeah. Falling for a little cheapo to finish things off there. And there's the queen. Thank you. Thank you very much. Nice game, actually. Good, good that I got a chance to throw out the wing gambit. I've been hanging out for one of those. So, quite enjoyed it. Nas from the United States, I believe. Have we played before? Nas, get on board. Clock's ticking. Clock's a ticking. Nas says, thanks. Don't thank me. Thank Leon. He's the man with the plan here. All right. Let's get some fianchetto action happening here. Nuss says, thought you were done. I'm never done. Never, never, never. What have we got here? Something weird. Something very weird. I don't think either Nuss or myself have a clue what's going on. Oh my God, he's fast. Oh my God, he was up on time more than 3 minutes. Nice. Unbelievable. That is quick play. Usually I'm not that far behind on the clock when a game starts. Might not have helped him too much here because I've got a pretty good position. He's probably thinking about the move knight b5, which certainly looks tempting. Although in the end he decided against it, and that means that I'm going to take the pawn and have a safe extra pawn, and that means that this game is not going to be the exciting dragon battle that we may have hoped for. Instead, it's going to be a somewhat unexciting endgame, one might predict, but an extra pawn. Sometimes you just got to take what lands. I was going to say, take what lands in your lap. I'm pretty sure that's the card expression, but as I say it out loud, I'm not entirely convinced anymore. You got to take what's coming to you. Maybe that's better. Yeah, poor Nasi got super, super fast opening, but probably didn't expect my rare continuation on move 7 there. I took on c6, took the knight back with the d-pawn. A little bit unexpected. It was played a few days ago by Ivanchuk. I'm trying to remember now who Ivanchuk did it against, and I can't, which is a bit concerning. Ivanchuk against Peter Lecko, yes. So in the European Championships going on at the moment, Peter Lecko from Hungary with white against the infamous Vasily Ivanchuk, the Ukrainian with black. And Ivanchuk played this move 7. D takes c6, offering the exchange of queens to go into a slightly worse but defensible endgame. Pretty sure Nas, on the other hand, had pre-moved there, had pre-moved his move 8e5, which is, in fact, the most popular move after B takes c6. I think that's where things went wrong, because e5 certainly not a good move after D takes c6. Not sure if that's at all interesting to you, but that's the theory behind this opening. Move 7, D takes c6, a little unusual, played most recently by Vasily Ivanchuk. Okay, it looks like I should be winning a pawn, but I honestly cannot see why. Why am I not just... I thought I was winning a pawn here. But apparently I'm not, so I'm going to play rook d4. Why was I not winning a pawn there? I had calculated a second ago. I must be getting tired. Maybe I'm winning a pawn now. Yeah, usually around this point in Banter Blitz, this is where the wheels start to come off of me. But maybe, well, now I'm just winning a piece, I believe. Yeah. Yeah, well, that was a much better result than anticipated. Kind of accidental, though. Poor Nas, undone by his own quickness by playing too quickly there on move number 8 with e5. Can happen. I feel your pain. All right. Okay, next one up. Taho Sam. I like the way that I said it better. Oh, it's my move. Sorry. How did I say it? Taho Sam. I've seen you pop up a few times in the chat, actually. I think. Yes. You want to win gambit again? Come on, guys. Let's do the win gambit again. I just can't help myself. What song is that? Sounds suspiciously like the Pet Shop Boys in my head, which is a bit concerning, because that's not something I would normally sing. Does anyone know that song? You know the song? I just can't help myself. If anyone knows the song that I've got bumbling around in my head, write it in the chat. It may or may not be the Pet Shop Boys, but it sounds a bit like that. We've gone Wing Gambit again. Poor Taho Sam is a little behind on the clock here and has decided to decline the gambit. Actually, it must be said that b6 is not the worst move in the world in that position. So it's not so bad, actually, what was just played. The real problem, though, is that in the French defense, particularly advanced variation, black typically goes for counterplay on the queen side, because that's the way the pawns are pushing. Now, if you don't know what I mean, look at the pawns at the moment. White's pawns on d4 and e5, black's on e6 and d5. Typically, think of them like an arrow. So here we've got f7, e6, d5 for black. They're pointing towards the queen side. That's typically a little hint that you should be playing on the queen side. Little piece. Tells you which side of the board you're typically going to have more space and that you should be pushing on. So here I've managed to get my pawn to b5, and that's really useful because the pawns are telling us that black should be putting all of his eggs into playing on the queen side, and I've managed to get a little space advantage over there. So that's it's very good news from my perspective at this point in time. On the other hand, I did just sacrifice a pawn for no reason that I can remember. So... a little bit of column A, a little bit of column B. But seriously, you can see that it's a tiny bit difficult for black's development here on the queen side. He'd much prefer it if that B pawn was all the way back on B2. Okay, so let's get back into it. I really want to focus because I really want to finish strong here. F4. Okay, let's do this. I'm feeling pretty good. So let's go for it. Should we keep going for it? How brave am I feeling? Perhaps not as brave as I made out. I just can't help myself. I just can't help myself. Does anyone know what that song is? I just can't help myself. Perhaps my singing is not helping us work out what it is. Okay, I'm going to get that pawn back on d4. That's good news. Notice that the typical problem piece for black in the French, the so-called French bishop, the bishop on c8, is really dead. You can see that bishop on c8 is totally incarcerated. That's good news. That's what white strategy is all about. According to Tired Dad, it is nothing to do with the Pet Shop Boys at all. Depeche? Depeche? Anyway, of course Tired Dad would know. Very good attempt there by Tahul Sam to play a6, but of course I'm not going to take that, baby. I want to keep a pawn on b5 because that's my real trump in this position. My real trump is that pawn on b5, which is blocking, really suffocating Black's queenside. And here I didn't want to play knight takes d4 because then after bishop takes d4, we'd end up in a situation of opposite colored bishops. Now, like I said, Black's bishop is pretty horrible, but still, no need to give those sort of drawing chances at this stage. It's quite clear that my knight is going to dominate if I can secure things, and things are looking pretty good. I have to say, I might just play king h1 here. I have been playing g4 quite a lot today, and I think I'm going to go for g4 again. Now, first, I'm just gonna secure everything on the side there. And is it time already for g4? Oh, I've got to be a tiny bit careful. I really want to go for g4 though. I'm going to say my opponent playing a very nice controlled game here. All things considered, I might go for rook a6. Try and get a... Oh, I missed that move. That's going to hurt me, I think. That's going to hurt me. Take. Oh, missed queen b8. That's a shame. Things were looking up. I try to trick my opponent here because I don't think bishop takes b5 works. He's played bishop takes b5. Oh, it does work. Oh, I'm so stupid. Oh. I thought that I was winning, but I totally messed this up. Hey, what happens to my opponent? Oh, he could have just played pawn takes c5. That was the mistake. And then if queen takes rook, pawn takes d4. And my opponent would be up by the exchange. Instead of my opponent being up by the exchange, my opponent is now down. Down two pieces to a rook. And I think just resigned or forfeited time or one or the other. But ooh, just missed that. B takes. Of course, he could just play pawn takes rook and then take the bishop. And I would be down by an exchange. That would have been interesting. All right. Thanks for the game. The skew. Are there any openings I haven't played? I don't think so. I think I've done everything that I could do, according to this little list I've got here. No, I haven't played the Berlin. I haven't had that many E4 openings. Oh, going in for this endgame, eh? This endgame is meant to be pretty much okay for black, I have to say. And the main reason why is because the king just sort of tucks into C7. And is usually pretty happy there. But again, this may not be the most exciting opening for people in the world, and I can appreciate that. It seems a bit strange to say that I'm feeling so comfortable when I've only just moved pawns and my king. But I do feel very comfortable in this position. And now the pieces start to come, and you can see I'm really controlling the key center squares. That's what's making my life so nice at the moment. And in particular, I've got control of d4 and c5, whereas my opponent does not have control of the d5 square and has no access to the c4 square. So some key differences in the symmetry of the position. Yes. Having said that, I just probably should have prevented that last move, but still, things should be okay. But there was no reason for me to allow this little sequence, because I'm going to play knight d7 with some trepidation, because the exchange sack rook takes d7 looks a bit concerning to me. Don't know if my opponent will go for it, but it sure does look strong. In fact, I better just pre-move bishop takes d7 just in case. Ooh, hasn't gone for it in the end. Yeah, it could be that was a lucky break from my side of things. All right. Now, I really need to get some control over those squares again. And I think the way to do that is to put something on c5. And I think that's going to be a rook. Yeah, that's a good move. Now, knight c5. Is it already time for knight c5? Maybe not. Maybe it's first knight e7 and next move. Next move into c5. Yeah, so after a3, just bishop c5. You can see I'm going to end up with doubled c pawns. But that's not a big concern to me, because most importantly, I'm going to have control over the center squares, and I'm going to have a semi-open B file. And the semi-open B file is going to be very important, because all the play is going to be around the weak pawns on B2 and C4. So it's quite a deep strategic concept, assuming that my opponent takes a second time on C5, which I imagine that he or she will, the skew there. So that's happened now. So this is a very instructive moment of the game. I thought this would be quite a boring endgame, but this is quite important now. So I've got these doubled c-pawns, but you can see the c-pawns can't be attacked, so they're not actually a weakness. Importantly, I've got the good bishop, and I've got some weak pawns to work on. So overall, this position should favor me, not by a great deal, but just by a little bit. Of course, having said all that, now this is the part where things will typically go wrong, so we'll find out. But I feel this position should be better for me now. So my opponent will probably double rooks here, and then I will immediately start my assault on the queen side. Let's see what happens. Hasn't doubled rooks. I think that was probably mandatory, because now I've got the double attack on the pawns. Had he doubled rooks, I was going to play knight b6 followed by a4, and I think the position's very pleasant for black. But now I'm probably just winning a pawn. And you can see that even though white can secure domination of the only open file in the position, you need entry squares. And here, no entry squares, largely thanks to my fantastic double C pawns. Speaking of which, they're now the only C pawns on the board after I snapped off that guy. And chance now to pick up chance to get those pawns going, excuse me. time to get those babies rolling. The skew running dangerously short on time, but I think it's probably too late now because I'm just going to play rook to b5. Excuse me. Now, I'm actually very, very tempted to just take that with the rook. In fact, I will just take it with the rook. My opponent's a bit short on time, so I can probably take a few risks here. Objectively, that probably wasn't the best move, but it certainly was the most tempting. And now, can I double? Do I play knight takes pawn? Or what's going on? Have I messed this up a little bit? I think I've messed this up a little bit, so I'm going to bail out here with c3. Apologies for that. I kind of forgot what I was doing for a second there. But I picked up the pawn on e4, and that's should be enough now. It's only one pawn, but I've got better pieces as well. Could be time to bring the king up. And my opponent simply has no time remaining. Fair call. Try and move some pieces on the side of the board, but my opponent's really fighting hard here. Got to respect that. That's dropping a pawn as well, isn't it? My opponent here fighting and fighting and fighting, but I think the exchange of pieces is in my favor. Now I've got these two pawns and should be a reasonably comfortable win from here, he says optimistically. Let's see, f4. The skew's been playing for so long on just these 2 second increments. I got to say that's it's been very impressive, but ultimately he's going to go down. Thanks for the game. Thanks for the game. Whew. Oh, apologies. I should have mentioned in advance that was, in fact, the last game. I'm sorry about that. I should have mentioned before it's the last game. I tried to do that, and Leon told me, but the brain's going, and I'm getting back into the swing of things. It's been a couple of months since I've been on Banter Blitz, but thanks a lot for joining us tonight. It's been a lot of fun. It's been a long-awaited return to Banter Blitz for me, and I've enjoyed it. Also, the new YouTube streaming, I like that as well. Thanks for the entertaining chat and conversation in the channel. I really liked that as well. Also, the comments on YouTube, don't think I've forgotten about you there. This should be some sort of fun social event as well as a bit of chess on the side. And, of course, big congratulations to Random. I think it's... was it 1-2-1-3-4-3-1-4-1-5? Sorry about that. A fantastic win. Thanks to everyone for joining in. It's been good. I'm glad to be back, and I always have a lot of fun with you guys. So join us next time. Also, join the other guys, Banter Blitz. I think there's a couple coming up still this month. Joel Benjamin's coming in at some point, which will be good. This has been Grandmaster David Smerdon from Australia coming to you from Amsterdam for ICC's Banter Blitz. Signing off. Until next time.